Isaac Asimov was the 1984 AHA Humanist of the Year and honorary president of our association from 1985 until his death in 1992. His wife, Janet Jepson Asimov, died on February 25th of this year. Like Isaac, Janet Asimov was a passionate supporter of AHA and a strong promoter of humanism and rational thought in our country. A profile of Janet in a recent issue of the Humanist magazine mentions her position on religion. She said in part, quote, "I can respect people, able to keep their minds open while enjoying whatever conventional organized religion they need, providing they don't depend on their religious organizations to do their thinking for them and tell them what to do," close quote. I think it's very appropriate that this year's Isaac Asimov Science Award be given to just such a person that Janet Asimov might have had in mind. Dr. Pamela L. Gay says that people who know her in real life know that while she is a very quiet voice in Christianity, she is a loud advocate for science. Indeed, she is. Dr. Gay is an astronomer, an educator, a podcaster, and a writer. She received her PhD in astronomy in 2002 from the University of Texas. In her day job, she is a senior education and communications specialist and senior scientist for the Planetary Institute. But perhaps Pamela is most recognized for her success in engaging people in both learning and doing science. Science is fun, for scientists, that is. Making it interesting and enjoyable to non-scientists requires much more than just knowing the science. It requires extraordinary communication skills, a sense of humor, a love of helping other people learn, and the ability to perform in a wide variety of media. Dr. Gay masterfully exhibits these talents through CosmoQuest.org, where people are engaged in both learning and doing science, and in media productions like Astronomy Cast, where Pamela and her co-host, Fraser Cain, take participants through a, quote, facts-based journey through our cosmos, exploring not only what we know, but how we know it, close quote. Astronomy Cast is in its ninth year of production, highlighting each new discovery coming out of the space science communities. CosmoQuest is a virtual research site designed to give the public opportunities to participate in NASA-related science programs while also giving them access to online seminars, star parties, classes, and more. Pamela has observed, and I quote, "We are researchers who think logically and live by reason, yet we are humans and are bound to our emotions. We are torn in every direction, research, family, teaching, community, and academic isolation. We are always driven to do more than we possibly can do and always feel there is something left undone. Why do I fight to win my way through so many mazes and masks? Because astronomers are also free to learn and discover the truths that no one has yet realized. And while we can never know fully the answers, the pursuit of that next piece of the universal puzzle drives me to drive myself to meet the challenges of all the characters that I am asked to play," close quote. So, it is with great pleasure for me to introduce Pamela in yet another role she has been asked to play, that of the 2019 American Humanist Association Isaac Asimov Science Awardee, Dr. Pamela Gay.
So I'm going to go old school and just talk to you. Memory is a strange and fickle thing. Not every moment is stored. Somewhere, I lost all the names of the dinosaurs that I knew when I was five. Somewhere is gone the family tree of Greek gods that I learned in fifth grade. There's an inexplicable alchemy to what is remembered. Did you know birds can't fart? Wombats, they poop cubes. Like, really, they're cubes. And the asteroid Ceres became a former planet more than 70 years before Pluto was even discovered. There are just some things that we can't forget. There's this one memory that stays with me. I was 12 years old in seventh grade, and I was getting teased for my intelligence as we lined up to go inside one morning. I can remember the crowding, the noise, and his retort, "You just think you know everything." And I still remember how I answered, "No, I don't, but someday I will." I was wrong. I will never know everything, but that hunger to try, to work each day to learn more and understand more, that hunger that existed in pre-teenage me, it is what has carried me to become and stay a scientist. Scientists aren't people who know everything. We are people that strive every day to expand humanity's understanding of this universe that we share. As I stand before you, I see echoes of that little girl in who I've become. Back then, I read all the science fiction I could, from the Star Trek novels that made my English teacher roll her eyes to Frank Herbert and Michael Crichton. Those two left me terrified of viruses and genetically engineered plagues. I'm not gonna lie, I still read way too much, and today it's the works of Gaiman, Jemison, Scalzi, Okafor, Wendig, and Lafferty that fill my ears and eyes as I whisper sync from audiobook to paper white in stolen moments that I find every single day. Back then, by day, I filled my days with astronomy news as I poured through the pages of Sky and Telescope. And then at night, I'd go out in the yard with my Sears discount bin telescope and try and find Mars. Well, today, my view comes from cameras mounted on spacecraft orbiting other worlds. And I get to write the astronomy news and share it online. This is where I think I'm supposed to say that you can tune in and catch the daily space, daily at 1 p.m. Eastern on CosmoQuest X on twitch.tv. Hi, everyone watching on twitch.tv. Today, sorry, I skipped ahead. It was in science and in science fiction that I have found my home. I grew up in a small town in Massachusetts, kind of like Isaac Asimov lived in Boston, but small town. I was teased in middle school, and when you're a girl who likes science, that teasing never really ends. I was a Cold War child, a Gen Xer growing up to a soundtrack of Billy Joel, reminding me that we didn't start the fire, but we tried, and we try to fight it. It was in Eleanor Ellie Arroway, in Carl Sagan's Contact, that I found my hero, my role model. As I lay in the grass, clinging to the earth, I felt myself like her, almost falling into the stars. I longed for something more, and it was in Sagan's fiction that something amazing was possible. The world could, for one moment, unite all of us as we worked to, well, science the shit out of something greater than all of us. Today, my iPhone is more likely to be playing Amanda Palmer than Billy Joel. But as I read my Twitter feed, as I listen to the talks here this morning, I think it's safe to say we didn't start the fire, but it is going on and on and on. The thing is, we have something that really only Asimov had fully predicted. We have the internet with a screen in our pocket. And through our constant connection, we are united, if only through domain name servers, to virtually the entire world. There is the potential for all of us to come together, one internet connection at a time. While I did grow up to get that same PhD in astronomy as the fictional Ellie Arrowood, I'm not someone who's looked for anything in my radio data other than radio galaxies. I'm not the kind of astronomer who can help solve global warming. All I can do is tell you it's real and it scares me. I'm not the kind of big data researcher who can pour through my tables of numbers and find a solution for all of the plastic that's filling our oceans. All I can say is bring your own cup and maybe pick up the ones that other people have cast away. There are so many problems out there that are bigger than me. Racism, the increasing economic inequality of people in this nation. Heck, I had to shut down Twitter yesterday just because I saw a picture of a pit bull that's about to be destroyed that I don't have the power to adopt. And this morning, I had to click away because of a photo of a pregnant female orangutan clinging to the last standing tree in a bulldozed rainforest. There is so much I can't fix, and some days I feel so impotent as I just want to do something as I fear our ecosystem is collapsing. I'm haunted by that episode of Star Trek: The Next Generation. It's called The Inner Light, where Picard lives out a dead man's life through a space probe's simulation. The simulation that is all that is left of a dead, dried out world's civilization. There's so much that I can't do. And there's one thing that I can do. I can science. And I can ask you to take out your phone or click into a new window on your tablet or your computer and use the internet to help me share the word. And not one of you just reached into a pocket to pull out a phone or a computer or a tablet. Here's the thing I want you to share on the social media, on WhatsApp, on that listserv that you're still using. We, all of us together, can help a tiny spacecraft called OSIRIS-REx find a safe place to grab a soil sample to bring back to Earth from the asteroid Bennu. Join me in going to bennu.cosmoquest.org and help me map out all the potential hazards that cover Bennu's surface. This half kilometer across asteroid is nothing we imagined. It looks like a load of rubble that some interplanetary dump truck accidentally lost between the planets. The surface is just rocks on rocks with boulders and more rocks. And you know what? Sometimes Bennu even ejects shrapnel into space. Mapping out this asteroid is tedious work that requires people, people like you, to digitally trace out the lengths of the boulders and mark the center of all those rocks that can do harm to our spacecraft. We have roughly 4,500 images that each need to be viewed by 15 people so that our spacecraft can start doing higher resolution follow-up images of the best looking regions for exploration. We have until July 10th to do this, and we can do this. We launched our website May 22nd, just 2 weeks ago. And already, our community, the world, has gone through more than 1,100 images. We can do this. Will you do this with me? Will you science with me? It may seem like folly to say, come, while the world, or at least my Twitter feed, burns. Let's map rocks on an asteroid millions of miles away. But this is something real. And this is one small step in the direction of making a world where people come together and do science. This is a way to bring people together, to do something meaningful in an arena where it shouldn't matter the color of our skin, what pronoun we choose, who we love, or in what gods or gods we do or don't believe. All of us, we can map rocks. It's so small a thing, but maybe it's enough. Maybe we can make our own community where the only thing that matters today is those rocks. And maybe tomorrow we can go map the moon. I've heard NASA's planning to go back there. I wish I could say science as a whole is a safe place where people are judged without bias by their accomplishments only. I wish I could say we all have an equal chance at success, but I can't. I could tell you about the harassment that I faced as a woman in science. I could tell you about the racism that I've witnessed, but that hurts too much. I could show you the research and the statistics, but why? It's not going to change anything. Instead, I want to map an asteroid at bennu.cosmoquest.org. And I'm not the only scientist saying, come, help me. Let's do these small things that matter so much. There's a project called Stall Catchers that needs you to help map out brains to help us cure Alzheimer's. There's a project called Budburst that's tracking the blooming of flowers, and the Ladybug Project, which has uncovered insects we thought were extinct. Will you join me? Will you join them? Will you join us as we escape into science? When I first found out I was getting this award, I have to admit, I did a quick review of Isaac Asimov's life. Like everyone else, I think his short story, Nightfall, is amazing. Read it if you haven't. I read his Galactic Empire and Foundation series 10 years ago in a summer binge. I loved them mostly. There are slow bits and not everything stood the test of time. But I think the fact that I raced through them in 3 months really says all you need to know. But loving someone's books doesn't mean that you want to have your name tied to your own. Before standing here, I needed to read about Asimov, the man, and what he did besides write. It turns out I had nothing to fear. And the more I read, the more I wished Asimov had lived to see how intersectional diversity is becoming a new normal in science fiction. Asimov believed that science fiction was an important way for humanity to see what is possible. And I dream that the society he fought for and imagined will become not just the new normal in fiction, but also in science. I wish he was still here. I wrote something as I defined our CosmoQuest community. I wish I could show him because I think it would make him proud. He died the year I graduated from high school. And since he isn't here, I'm going to read it to you instead. At CosmoQuest, all are welcome. In this time when there are too many global tragedies taking place local to too many of our community members, I want you to know we wish for you to be safe, be well, and come help us explore our universe when you can. Our hope is that if we acknowledge, as stated so well by Astronomers with Borders, that we are all one people sharing one sky, maybe it will be easier for us to show each other compassion and understanding. There are too many places in our world that are literally and figuratively on fire for me to list them and ask for you to act to help those who need help. Instead, I want to say that in this place, we will tolerate no hate. This is a place where people are accepted without regard to their color, culture, religion or lack of religion, their education level, their wealth, or their caste. We do not care who you love, but only that you find love in this world. We believe that everyone can do great things, and we want you to be part of us doing great things. If you have the capacity to act, please help those who need it. If you just need a safe place for your mind to find sanctuary in science, please come here and be welcome. When I first wrote this, I ended the paragraph there. It seemed like a reasonable place to end it. And about 45 minutes later, I went back and I added another paragraph. And when I first wrote this talk, and in fact, up until about 20 minutes ago, I stopped the quote there. But listening to the last section, the last session, I went to read that next paragraph that I went back and I wrote. This article didn't originally state Black Lives Matter because I couldn't find an adequate way to also express our sorrow for refugees and other people killed through hate, apathy, and silence. No life should be thrown away. When humans with the potential to be the next Albert Einstein or Chris Hadfield are washed up on beaches, are being struck down walking home with Twizzlers, and sometimes just die dancing or playing in the park, I have no words to express my sorrow. Our support does not say these lives matter more than others, but rather we recognize that culturally, in different ways, in different places, some populations are treated as though they matter less. This is wrong. We are proud of the people within CosmoQuest who are peacefully participating in the Black Lives Movement in pride, and those who are opening their homes and communities to people escaping potential death in their native lands. We see your compassion and we commend it. I'm just a scientist, just a girl who wanted to know everything. I'm a person trying to make that place where we can all learn and do science together so that that science fiction reader in me that dreams of a world where we are all united to do something, let's make that world. Thank you for this award that ties my name to Isaac Asimov. I'd like to believe he'd help me measure boulders and mark rocks. And since he's not here, will you? Together, we can explore our universe. Thank you.
Thank you so. Thank you so much, Dr. Pamela Gay. One more round of applause, please. We have some time for some questions, so we will entertain questions from the audience and also from online, our audience there. So if folks have a question, go ahead and raise your hand, and so I can come around to you.
Okay. And all of astronomy is fair game. We're only one in a million on this planet, and you've got one here right now.
And if you've agreed to join Dr. Gay and others in sciencing together, that we can hear from that too. Here we go.
What was the website again where we can count rocks?
Bennu, B-E-N-N-U, bennu.cosmoquest.org.
How would you suggest educational improvements in the world, early education for science-oriented education, because there are too many education systems, including religion, which dominates actually millions of kids, like from Chicago, all over the world probably, get education very early stage. Even though they meet the curriculum, they're still Orthodox religious schools. That means they are doing something to impact, which to some extent must stop, in my opinion. But you may have any other ideas how to do that better way.
So there's two things I want to say. The first is a reaction to the question, and the second is an answer. The reaction part is we need to be very careful with our language. The Catholic Church runs some of the best observatories in the world and are doing cutting-edge science. The reason that much of today's science and math survived the Dark Ages is the Muslim religion and the Islamic people writing down what was lost in Europe. We need to recognize that there are crazies among us in all walks of life who are willing to disregard the world as it's taught to us by science. And sure, a lot of them are extremist Christians. A lot of them are being taught to disregard science in these extreme fundamentalist environments. But we need to make sure to remember all of our adjectives, because there's a problem with people who have beliefs hearing scientists who are atheists basically say, religious people don't know science. And they're like, I can't learn this. I'm going to leave. And that is a problem. And the next thing we need to do is inspire curiosity. We all forgot what we learned in fifth grade science. Heck, I forgot a lot of what I knew in ninth grade science. Back then, I got a perfect score in my biology SATs. Nowadays, I remember the phrase Krebs cycle, have no idea what it is. If we can teach people curiosity, if we can teach them the scientific technique, if we can teach them the power of data and exploration, and get them to always keep asking questions, that is what we need to do. The exact curriculum, people can argue that till the sun comes down. Until the sun blows up. And no one will have an answer. But curiosity, participatory science, and hands-on engagement that teaches kids how to learn, that is what needs to happen.
What do you think about the way people's scientific curiosity, their natural curiosity, is sometimes satisfied by mainstream pseudoscience? Like in your field, astrology, for example.
Yeah. So this is where we've failed people. One of my favorite things to point out to people that are really into astrology is that there are actually 13 constellations the sun passes through. The constellations come in a whole variety of different sizes. Cancer is luckily small, Scorpius is not, and Sagittarius sits somewhere in between. And there's Ophiuchus sitting next to it, and we don't talk about Ophiuchus. But according to the Greek-based zodiacal signs that are used in modern horoscopes in most of the Western world, all those constellations are the exact same size. Because it's just how they marked out their year. And that doesn't make sense. If the sun was in Ophiuchus when I was born, why am I called a Sagittarius? And the first peoples of our world whose culture has been maintained for 70,000 some odd years, the San people of southern Africa, often referred to pejoratively and historically as the Bushmen. The San people, in their original sky mythology, saw our sky as nothing more than a solid body, they got that part wrong, above us, that has no impact on us. Let's go back to the first peoples. They might have learned something over time.
Hello. I think we all agree, or at least the two of us will agree, there's a problem in the Earth, you know, with environment and, you know, kind of destroying the Earth that we have. We also look at the sky and we get very inspired by that, you know, potentially a future in the stars. And Star Trek promised me warp drive.
Yeah.
So, you know, as an astronomer who probably has these similar feelings all the time, what do you think about the, you know, the talk about, you know, going to the moon or Mars or somewhere else as a solution to destroying this planet?
It's not a solution. Love science fiction. That kind of came out a little bit in my talk. There's a Neal Stephenson novel that is four digits starting with the number 2 set in the future. I'm bad at remembering names. And in this book, our Earth has become almost uninhabitable, but we're working to reestablish it. And they have worked to support the life that can't exist on our world with so much difficulty in spun up, hollowed out asteroids and artificial ecosystems and other worlds. And it is a struggle that goes on for generation upon generation upon generation, because it is so hard to rehabilitate a world. And one of the things that is devastating to me is the Paris Accords, which the US didn't buy into, works to hold our world to only 2 degrees of climate change. And we're already past the point where it's going to be more than that. The majority of the world's populations lies along coasts. The majority of our world's populations are going to be displaced. Our economy is going to crash. Our planet is going to be fine. It's a planet. It does not care. But its ability to support life as life exists now, we already see so much being lost. And this is the only world that supports us today. We don't know how to get to Mars without destroying life through radiation poisoning, and that is a problem. And Mars can't support us. The moon is basically death on orbit. One bad coronal mass ejection, and if you aren't in a cave, you're gone. And I'm really worried that we're on our way to being gone. And that's all I've got. Sorry to end on that note. Can we have one short, happy question? Yes.
Wait, just a second. Is it true that in the field of astronomy, there's like half women scientists?
Hell no.
Oh, no. Okay.
That was not a happy question. At the senior level, we're like 11% women. Yeah. Sexism is real. Just Google my name and harassment. That's all you need to do. Can we now have like a black hole related question? I demand a black hole related question. I don't think so. As a software developer, there are not nearly enough programming errors for us to be a simulation. Okay, that was cheerful. You laughed. I'm going to go take a seat and listen to one of my heroes, Salman Rushdie. By the way, do not listen to his books while walking through Disney World alone, because you'll look like you're going to cry and confuse everyone.
Thank you so much. That's terrific.